everyone. The Chennai startup ecosystem doesn't exist without two words today. One is WSquare, and the other word is Vandhana here. WSquare, and as I've entered the startup ecosystem of Chennai 7 months back, constantly I've been hearing WSquare in different forms, right? Either as part of enablement programs they do, or as part of the various workshops we do, and the very fact that they are actually helping women get back to work and get back into entrepreneurship. So I have the pleasure of talking to Vandhana today. Thank you for the time.
Thank you so much.
And this is something that I've been wanting to do for quite some time, the moment that I met you at Tycon Chennai, right? So the series that we do here, we want to understand more about what's WSquare, how did it come to your mind and all that. So, but before I get into that, you've been a corporate employee for some time.
Right.
And a lot of wannabe entrepreneurs also go through the cycle of being a corporate employee and then look at entrepreneurship at subsequent point in time.
Right.
So in your journey as from an employee to an entrepreneur, can you kind of briefly tell us what did you found as the most challenging thing to do?
Right.
The shift in there, what was the mindset change that you had to bring in from thinking as an employee, from thinking as an entrepreneur? So what is that journey like?
So I worked in Cognizant for almost 4 years, and I was more into business development and content writing. And I enjoyed my stint over there. I got to travel a lot, and I really loved the work that I was doing. I had a very good team with me. But then I had to take a break after maternity, like so many other women. I think more than 80% of women do that.
Yeah.
They take a maternity break. So after my son was born, I took a break, and I decided that I actually wanted to spend more time with him, which is what again happens to a lot of women.
Yeah.
So I decided to quit because of that, because I want to stay back and spend as much time as possible, and working full-time was not doing that well for me. But I have been working since I was 18, so even right from college I've been doing part-time jobs and immediately got placed and I've been working. So sitting at home is not something that I could do. So I was getting very frustrated. I did a little bit of home businesses. I tried to sell jewelry. I tried to take summer classes. I went for a part-time in my old school. So I was actually a teacher for almost a year, where I used to work from 9 to 12, and then I used to pick up my son from school and then go back home. But again, that was not fulfilling for me. So even though I got a lot of opportunities to MC and compare and all that, so then I decided to go back full-time, and I joined an advertising agency, which is completely different from a corporate company.
Okay.
I worked in an advertising agency for almost 1.5 years, and though again there, the type of exposure that we got was amazing. It was a proper 9-to-6 job, and sometimes I had to stay back till 7 or 7:30, and that didn't go well because I had 2 children now, and I had to take care of them, and I had a family to support, and you know, the general chores that every woman has to do had to be done from my side as well. Though I had a very supportive family, those are some things that you have to do as a woman. You feel it's a responsibility to take care of your family. So that's when it got me thinking. So the biggest challenge for me was to maintain that 9-to-6 timing. The flexibility was not there for me. And of course, when you're working for a corporate or for any company, you need to take a check on the number of offs that you take. And though companies had policies to, you know, work from home, they were not very open about it. You can't take too much, you know, you can't take off at once a week or so and
right,
stuff.
Right.
So that's when I decided that, you know, though I loved it, though I loved the travel, the experience, I decided that this was not going to work out for me, because it was too much of a stress. One, the balancing of the, you know, the career and at home was getting a lot for me, and the travel also. So I had to travel all the way to Nungambakkam for work,
mm-hmm.
and when it was in Cognizant, I had to travel all the way to Nawalur for work, and that was it was very bad, because I had to start by 7:38 to reach office by 9 o'clock with the traffic and all of that,
sure.
and it was going crazy. And by the time I could come back home, even if I started 6:30, I was home only by 8. So which means I lost a lot of time traveling.
Right.
So that's when I decided that this is not something that would work. And we realized that there were a lot of women out there. The reason that they quit their jobs was because of travel, was because of the guilt that they felt that they were not able to, you know, provide enough, be enough for their children.
Yeah.
And that break, because of society, because of family, they were forced to be at home and work from home, even after marriage, not just after children. So that's when we spoke to a lot of women. We had a huge, we already had a lot of women that we were speaking to. And we formed a digital marketing agency where we never have an office space. So throughout the 3 years of our company, we never had an office space. We used to work remotely from home. And we used to provide projects to women who were at home,
okay.
Designers and content writers. And we used to give them a lot of projects from there.
Sure.
So my partner and I used to go meet. So I did this along with my partner, Gina, who also worked in the ad agency. So we basically found clients, met our clients in a lot of coffee shops, because we didn't have an office.
Sure.
got them and used to give those projects to our, these work from home women. So they used to work on project basis and on deliverables. So they used to give us a repository of 1 month of course. Because it's very unpredictable when you work with women from home.
True, true.
So they used to give us like a month of deliverables and we used to make sure that it goes out to the client. So we were like the mediator between the clients. The issue that we found was a lot of women, even though that they wanted to, there was something that would stop them. We never used to get some things on time.
Okay.
Suddenly they would become unavailable, we would not be able to contact them, or suddenly they would just come forward and say, I can't. So then we realized that even though working from home was a great idea, the productivity was not the same as it would be somewhere else.
Sure, sure.
So that's when we went and we used to work at a lot of co-working spaces as well. We tried to take up 2-3 co-working spaces and we realized that there were not a lot of women over there. I mean, they didn't even realize that these co-working spaces exist and it actually helped them.
Sure.
And more than a space, they were looking at a community of women where they could talk to them, understand from them. Maybe if I had a mentor for me who told me how I could maintain a work-life balance, I would have still worked in a corporate company.
Right.
So we realized that type of a mentor, the type of a community was not existing anywhere.
Right.
And that's when we thought, why not do something that will help women coexist, be together, understand and learn from each other.
Okay.
And that's how WSquare was born. So that has been my journey from corporate to an ad agency to a complete startup that we did on our own. So that's how it went in. And these are the challenges which we tried to take in and convert that into actually an
opportunity. Yeah.
Yeah,
so it's been one challenge at a time, you solve one of it, then you discover the next one, then you figure out a solution for the next one. Nice.
Yes, very
so
true.
So you actually brought out an important point, right? Women at workforce, and more specifically, women have been the teachers to the brightest of the minds, right? So we see women in workforce is not it's far better than what was a few years back, right? In IT companies you see almost a 60-40% ratio of that, right?
Right.
But the point that you brought about as to women as entrepreneurs or women as controllers of their own destiny and their time and all that. Why is there a big difference from women in entrepreneurship versus women in workforce?
Right.
What do you see are the other challenges that women have to face through to actually be the masters of their own time and be the masters of their own destiny?
Right. So if you see that women in entrepreneurship, they take up products, they take up ideas which have very limited barriers to entry. As in, it's easy come, easy go. So you see a lot of home-based women entrepreneurs here.
Right, right.
There is a small who try to do something different, come up with innovative, get into tech. But there's always this majority of women who do something which has less investment, which has less risk, so that they can just finish it and go. And they don't have the confidence to scale up their businesses. I think these are the three major problems that they have. And the reason that they have is they have limited access to networks.
Right.
To go and understand that this an idea is something that can actually become big.
Yeah.
They have limited access to finance. Most of the women don't have any idea about government grants that are available for them.
Mm-hmm.
Bank loans that are actually available for women entrepreneurs exclusively, or investors, angel investors, VCs that are ready to actually help fund women. So I think these three, or the access to these three, is very limited for women. So which makes them come up with a lot of ideas which are very very simple, so that they don't have to push too much into it. So I think that is a major roadblock that I find for women in entrepreneurship.
Okay.
Women in the workforce is, like I said, it's the work life that they're unable to cope with. So they're either able to completely be productive at work,
mm-hmm.
nor are they able to be completely productive at home. Of course, there are a lot of women who are able to balance it. They have an amazing support system, but I'm talking about women who don't have that support system.
Right.
The micro families that we see
sure.
who are, end of the day, it's you need to come down and sacrifice if there's any meetings are coming up. It's
true.
Not the men. We don't expect that. That's
okay.
A gentle mindset that we have.
Okay.
Slowly, it is changing. Men are coming forward, but it's a mindset that's been for centuries. It's not, it's gonna not take that easy to
correct.
Change, right?
Correct.
So that I find is the biggest problem when it comes to women. And a lot of women, when they get back to work, so this is a problem that we find. So when they take a sabbatical for 3 or 4 years after children and they decide to turn back to work, they end up working below their peers.
Mm-hmm.
So they would have been in a senior position, but by the time they are back,
mm-hmm.
Their peers have actually gone up and they have been
right.
a level where they need to work under them.
Correct.
So that kind of an ego, you know, it just doesn't feel so good. So that is another issue a lot of women face. And so what they try to do is they try to change the track of their career. They try to, do something else different.
Mm-hmm.
So that again is that disparity is again, I think, is very visible when women enter the workforce.
Right,
these are the problems that we have been seeing and trying to see how we can remove that whole obstacle.
So just talk us through that journey, right? So you talked about how WSquare came into being,
right.
Associated with WSquare, as more as a I consume a lot of content that you put out, consume a lot of workshop that you put out, so I have a very limited view of what all went through it. So can you tell us, like, what were the big objectives, goals that you set out, you and Jainal, when you started out? What did you have, what the plans were, what did you want to, you talked about some of the challenges, how were you trying to address that?
Right.
And where have you come so far in the journey?
Okay, so to be very honest, what was our objective is not anymore. Something that we decided when we started WSquare is not something that we're doing.
Okay.
But we are very clear on one. Whatever we do will be only for women. So that objective has always been the same.
Sure.
But initially we wanted to start as a co-working space. So like you see, the co-working space here is like any other normal co-working space. We have Wi-Fi, we have conference facilities, we have unlimited tea, coffee, we have reserved and open spaces. But apart from that, what we also do is we provide groceries and vegetables for women at the space. We have a daycare center for them. We have counseling sessions. We have beauty on-call services. Our entire space is air purified for pregnant mothers to come in and work out of here. All our infrastructure, the chairs are all ergonomic chairs so that it's easy for women after birth to come and work out of the space. So these are the facilities that made us, differentiated us from the similar co-working spaces.
Yeah.
So the WSquare co-working space, so though we got a lot of market validation, we were there in all news channels, nobody came in and used the space. So everybody called us up and said it's an amazing initiative, we loved it, but they did not understand. So women in Chennai did not understand the concept of co-working. Like I said, there were so many co-working spaces across, but we never saw a lot of women there. Like only like 10% of them would have been there.
Yeah.
So we tried to explain to them the purpose of a co-working. It was not just getting a space for yourself, but apart from, say, helping you save money, it also is an ecosystem where you speak to a lot of community of women.
Right.
So we told them that, instead of taking up an office space, spending on rent or an advance or an electricity, you just come here, you work and you go. That's all that you're looking at. You just have to focus on your business.
Right.
And that is the message that we're trying to send across. Now, while we were doing this, we met a lot of women who came to us, and the women that were using our space used to come and tell us that, I love this fact that you're giving me a space, but I'm also looking at people where I can do marketing. I don't know how to market my product. So a lot of women came to us and told us that, I have a product for like almost 8-9 months, but it's not selling. Can you help me with that?
Mm-hmm.
And some of them said, I don't know how to manage my finance. How do I price what I'm doing?
Sure.
There are a lot of startups who came and asked us, can you give me access to investors, to VCs? A lot of them didn't know there was a TAI or a BNI or a lot of other women forums and women entrepreneurs in India. And so many things are around. A lot of them didn't know that these kind of networks even existed, and they came to us asking a lot of questions like this. So we used to always be here.
Mm-hmm.
So we used to talk to every woman who used to come in, ask them for feedback, what do they think? And slowly we realized that women need a community who need a support to actually help them move forward.
Right.
And that's when we started up the whole, the series of programs that we kept having. And there were also a lot of home-based women entrepreneurs who did not get that push to become more successful and more public. That's where we started the marketplace.
Mm-hmm.
So we basically divided it into two. So one was the co-working space that we did, and there was another called a marketplace which we introduced. So the marketplace were more for home-based women entrepreneurs to come out and sell their products.
Mm-hmm.
So we convert this entire space into an event, which we do every month.
Okay.
We promote and push the products for women, and they come and sell the products here. So they have a hands-on experience on how to sell, how to price, how to negotiate. So they had more experience on that. And through that, we started doing a lot of workshops. So to increase visibility, these home-based women entrepreneurs, we used to talk to them, and they conducted a lot of workshops here on their expertise.
Okay.
So there were a lot of workshops on, say, soap making and jewelry making and all those kind of painting, calligraphy. We have some on doodle and all of that. So women started to be more open. They started to network, and we found a lot of women who also wanted to get into these type of home-based jobs as well.
Sure.
So that is what we did with the marketplace. We wanted to connect with as many women entrepreneurs on board, and any idea that we found was very good to be scaled up, we try to connect them with angel investors who are interested in actually working with home-based women entrepreneurs to scale up their businesses. So that was one. And the second is we found, so this is just more of the home-based community. They have very limited barriers. They're very happy sitting at home. So we wanted them to go out there and scale up their business. This is something that can be done nationwide. They can tie up with their Amazon workplace. They can tie up with online, a marketplace. Mm-hmm. These are things that they never knew that they could do. So those were the access that we tried to give them to scale up their business.
Sure.
The second were women who had good business ideas, more of the tech startups that were there, and who wanted to look at investors, who wanted to take it to the next level, who were more very serious and who had a team working in an office and all that. So they wanted help in different aspects. So right from financial management to digital marketing to branding, PR, or even a general one-on-one counseling is something that they needed. Right. So that's when we started. We realized that there needs to be something that will bridge a gap for women here, where they have an all-inclusive service. So that's when we came up with the incubation program for women. So that's how WinCubate was started. So WinCubate basically focuses on incubation program for tech and non-tech startups. Mm-hmm. So this SMEs and the startups. So I'm looking at women mainly either early stage or growth stage startups, which are women led.
Right.
So we understand when it's startups, you can't have an all women team. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at women led startups where women is the founder or the co-founder.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we talk to them and we try to see how we can help them through our 1 month program and connect them with the right type of people. So that is something that we started and we incubated to company, to startups. And they are in the process of launching their products as well. They are more of the ideation stage. So they have an idea and we help them get the mentors to get their product on board. We are now working on growth stage startups and we are trying to see how we can help them get into investors and have a demo day. So that is something that we are doing right now.
Sure.
So we felt that there was a need here and there was also need for them to improve their skill building. So we ran a 1 month skill building course and we are planning to have more of that there.
Yeah.
We got an amazing response. We had more than 150 women who were part of this mixed crowd, but more of women were there who were part of this entire series.
Right.
And they were able to leverage on whatever they learned. So the feedback that we got was they were able to use it in any one aspect of their business.
Right.
Right? So we had a whole 1 month series. That is something that we are planning to continue along with their incubation program. And then we come to tech. So now we have slowly moved into finding women in tech. There's a common misconception that women in tech are not much available compared to men in tech.
Yeah.
So we are looking at removing that misconception that women have, and slowly we are tying up with a lot of partners for this, and we are going to have the India's first women hackathon in fintech and AI.
Okay.
So we are coming up with three problems related to women entrepreneurs that we expect women-led teams to solve. So that is something that's coming up next month, and which is again going to be followed by a startup series that we have. So the startup series is basically for women who have an idea, who have an investment but don't know how to go forward.
Right.
So right from ideation to validation to execution and then financial production and getting it out to the market is something that we are going to help them with, which is going to be like an entire 3 month program that we have in place. We have also partnered with the company, so we are planning to do this in Chennai and Bangalore. So we are slowly looking at scaling up.
Sure.
And we also have a lot of community talks that keep happening. For example, mentor talks is something that happens every Friday where we have mentors from different leading industries to talk about their experience.
Mm-hmm.
Brand talks is something that we have started, which talks about a brand story of each company.
Sure.
Similarly, we have something called Mother Diaries. We have something called Startup Failures that we are going to launch, mm-hmm. which talks about how a failure of a company actually helps you learn.
Yeah.
So those are the talks that we have in place. So we realize that women need a lot of mentors and they need a lot of learning, and this community is something that they can help.
Right.
And we also host a lot of networking events. We have done almost 4 networking events, which has had more than 700 women to 200 women have been there. We have done a digital marketing summit,
mm-hmm.
Where we had 200 women in IIT coming in, and it was a 1 day long event where they learned about doing digital marketing, how digital marketing was very important for your business.
Sure, sure.
We had something called Now 2017 last year, which basically spoke about how women getting back to work,
mm-hmm.
how women entrepreneurship is very important. So we keep hosting a lot of events like this so that we get access to a lot of women and they also get to network and talk to each other. So it's very empowering for us to know that when women come to us and say that I got this particular contact and because of which I'm collaborating with them, I'm partnering and I've expanded my business, or I got into a program through your event,
mm-hmm.
or I got an investor through your event, is something that is very fulfilling for us.
Yeah.
So that is what we have been planning to do along. So we have a lot of things lined up next year. So.
So if I see it's, rather than being a roof to provide space for people to kind of come and work, you've kind of taken a complete leap into being a virtual and a physical incubator of sorts, right? So, and the beacon that carries the message that women can get into entrepreneurship, be it tech or homepreneur or whatever, right? So you're kind of carrying that message across. So in this transition, can you give us some insights into how the women have received this? You talked about two startups they've incubated, now they're getting their ID from, they entered with an idea but now getting to the launching of product. So to inspire other women who probably are now cat on the wall, so to say, should I do this? Is it for me? Right. Am I made out, cut out to do this?
Right.
Because like it's more about the market putting a lot of challenges, but your mind itself plays a lot of, it's a devil's advocate every second, right? For women, I think it's much more prominent than men, right? To take the risk and jump on and do that. So what are some of the inspiring stories we could share in terms of women that have gone through this journey? Like if you could name a few and talk about how their journey has been, how that can be an inspiration for other women who are actually in the cusp of making a decision of whether to stay at the home or to get into something like this.
You
are certainly an inspiration, but you and Gina, other stories you could share.
Sure, definitely. So there is a very good contact that we got through WSquare called Rajati, who initially started off with, she's a woman in tech. So she initially started off with an all-women team with just two or three people, and they came up with an app called WSquare, which was more of a marketplace for the kirana stores and how you connect them to people. So she was part of one of our events and she got into the startup leadership program. And she realized that instead of focusing on everything, they probably could focus only on one particular aspect. And she moved into the organic marketplace. And she started building her product more. She was part of a lot of the workshops. And we connected her to Zoho. And they are now using their technology for their product. And now they've got an investor from Germany to scale up their product. And they're going to take up our space also in 2 months. Okay. So that is an inspiring. So I've been watching her from the time she was a two-member team to a point now where she's actually got an investor on board and she's making into a complete women in tech team.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a great story to tell, from small to where she just recently went to Germany, met the investor. They're coming here on board to completely invest in her company and make it big and scale it up for her. So I think that's an amazing story. So she was also in an IT company for almost, I think, 10 years or so. Mm-hmm. And coming in now is something great. Another person that I can probably talk about is Anjali Anand, I think. Awesome chef. Yeah. So that's again someone we have been talking to from the beginning. So she's a very vibrant young woman. She's part of all the meets that we have, all the mentor talks that we have. She's been with us throughout. We have also done, collaborated a lot of programs together. So right from just a delivery of home, pre-made meals, she's now moved into nutrition and health and fitness. Yeah. And that is something also, I think it's very inspiring to see. There was also another woman who used to work out of our space. She used to run a company called Mudalia's Kitchen. Her children had settled down, and she was living here alone because the children had settled up. So she just wanted to do something with her life.
Sure.
And she came up with her own cooking space. So she was unable to sell her products from home because there were too many Swiggy. So she partnered with Swiggy for this. And there were too many women, too many men coming in to take, parcels from her, and it became a problem at her housing community.
Okay.
So we provided her a virtual place where she can come and sell her products from here and they take it from
Okay.
So I think that was amazing. We get a lot of calls from women who are in their late 40s to 50s who call up and say that my children are settled, I have nothing to do, but I have an investment with me, I have like 5 lakhs or so with me, I want to do something, can you help me out? So that two of these college girls that we said we recently incubated have amazing products in hand, very encouraging. So both of them are, both the products are completely different. One is a more of a social enterprise where she's looking at creating her own customized box which helps motivate people when they are down.
Yeah.
So we have connected her to a couple of psychologists. We have connected her to a couple of companies which make handmade boxes to help her customize. So we give her these connects and we also helped her in the financial projection because she's just out of college.
Yeah.
So now she's getting into branding and looking at how she can get the market out. Another girl is something that we are going to work again with her. She comes all the way from Kanchipuram just for this incubation program. She also has an amazing idea which has not been done before. It's a tea bag concept of fruits. So you get to make fruit juices with a tea bag.
Okay.
So she has already, you know, tried 2-3 combinations, and I think she does one in lime, another one in pomegranate, which is amazing. I mean, we have tasted it. She's done a couple of samples. It's really great. And now she's looking at how she can take it forward. We have already had them part of a couple of our startup programs over here, mm-hmm. where a lot of investors are actually given interest in, you know, doing more with them.
Right.
So all that we need is now for the push for her to get the product out, and we already have 3 investors who are interested in investing in them. So again, that is something that we're very excited about. We are working along with them. So these are the type of, and there are a lot more. I mean, we get to meet different women every day. Even the home-based women entrepreneurs that we see are amazing. They have amazing ideas with them. They just need that push to get it scaled up.
Right.
So we are trying to talk and form a community of these home-based women entrepreneurs and try and see who is interested to do much bigger. We have a lot of mentors who have been supporting us for this. We have the Naturals owner, Mr. C.K. Kumaravel, who actually wants to do more of this.
Sure.
We are
doing
a couple of projects with him. Yes Bank is one of our alliance partners who are interested in helping any way possible for women who are getting into tech.
Mm-hmm.
And for the hackathon, we spoke to STPI and they're ready to give us the entire space for the hackathon, which can hold up to 150-200 women. So we are slowly getting into that mode where we're getting a lot of partners. Now that we have validation and we have experience in this, we are slowly getting more partners on board who can actually help women in different aspects of their entrepreneurship building. So,
sure.
Just a small set of numbers that we've seen so far.
No, I think it's quite inspiring to see, like, the variety of things.
Yes.
And how they have kind of, like you said, a challenge to an opportunity, right?
Right.
So, whether you're home based or not, so your dreams can still live and breathe and fly from wherever you are.
Right.
So, I mean, I want to kind of go back to ask another question. So, I think a lot of examples that we talked about are women who have been in the workforce for some time, or women who have kind of now get the additional spare time because these children have settled down and all that. But I'll go back and say women or girls who are just graduating from college, right? So now, at least I've started to see in Chennai where a lot of kids just out of college, right? This used to be the NCR, Delhi, and Mumbai kind of, Bangalore kind of people where they're not looking for jobs at all. They're just directly getting into entrepreneurship because, like, they see that they can actually carve their own destiny, right? How do you see that vis-a-vis for women or girls who are graduating from, is that a target base for you? Is that, like, are you looking at spotting talent or right out of the college and trying to see, give them the opportunity? Because at that point in time, all the work-life balance, the marriage, the kids are not there, right? So then they can actually spread their wings much farther and fly much further, right? So is that something that you're looking at to kind of encourage more?
So our first incubation program was at MOP Vaishnav, where we chose MOP Vaishnav students. So three of the teams were out of college. So yes, definitely they're very hyper. In fact, I even went as a chief guest for one of the colleges in Kolhapur, which is more of a social initiative where they have college students from different villages to be there. So I went and gave a talk over there, and I had almost 10 to 15 girls who wanted to start something on their own.
Sure.
They wanted to either be a makeup artist, or they wanted to get in the field of cinema, or they wanted to get into writing, or they had a retail store that they wanted to do on their own.
Right.
So definitely a lot of girls are there who want to come out and do something on their own. But I find two main problems when it comes to startups from colleges.
Right.
So they, all of these women, if you see, these girls rather, which they typically want to earn. So they want to go for a job, they want to earn, and then do this on a side. That never works, right? So you have to be in company. So there are a couple of, Ananya from Inner Quarters Academy. She's been doing a wonderful job. She started this when she was in college.
Sure.
She's still not finished college, but she helps women get back to work. She has a huge training program, but she has an excellent support system. Her, you know, her parents are helping, you know, getting the funding for her. So there are girls like that who are into, you know, from college, but the main issue is that they first want to be financially independent before they can get into the whole startup.
Right.
Or there are these women, these girls that I met in the college, the family is not that supportive for them to start something on their own. They would prefer them work for 2-3 years and then settle down and get married.
Yeah.
And then decide what they want to do.
Correct.
So that seems to be a big roadblock, but we always welcome women out here. In fact, for college girls, we provide a discount if they want to come and use the space. And if they have a good idea, we're ready to encourage them as many as possible. In fact, for the hackathon, we are tying up with a couple of colleges to encourage them to come and try this and give them a direct interview opportunity with a couple of IT companies as well, so that they can go and they can be a part of the incubation program by the company, mm-hmm. or they can get into a, they have an interview opportunity to go get a job over there. Right. We want to make sure we empower in any one way possible.
Sure.
But this is the issue that I see, that in a financial independence is still not there, and they're still a little bit apprehensive to start something on their own, worried that it'll be successful. There are a couple of girls who have done it, who have a good support system, definitely I think they can do it, but that's still something that needs to come out from society, families.
You already talked about a lot of ways in which the startup ecosystem is positively responding to your journey and your goals and objectives. You talked about a lot of mentors coming forward.
Right.
Mr. Kumar Veli said, lending his time, possibly money as well.
Right.
A lot of investors coming forward and all that. So, what do you think? I'm sure it's a block process, right? So, the initial believers would kind of get on board, but then. So, what do you think is still missing in the startup ecosystem? Is there something, if you had to point out to saying that if this were there, it would be much better for women to get back into entrepreneurship? Is that, beyond the societal problems and all that, the ecosystem as such, where do you see is the next big hurdle that you want to kind of take help the ecosystem to solve?
So I think the biggest problem for women to come out is women themselves. I think they first need to get out of that notion that they need to be there. And they cannot take risks or move forward and do something big.
Right.
I think that we always follow the motto that a woman's success is the tribe of women that hold her back. It's something that we believe in. So women either hold her back or they let her down. Mm. Only two things that we can do.
Yeah.
So if women has to come up, there has to be a tribe of women who are going to support her. I would never talk about the family or the society. It's always something that everybody should get out of with. Even for a man, I think if he has to start up, it's going to be a challenge for him. Because man is always expected to bring in a set salary to the work home. So getting into a startup is of course a difficulty for him. So that works for both genders. But I think for women, it's themselves, right? You need to have the confidence to come out. You need to have that assertiveness to say no to getting back to work and getting into entrepreneurship, or just getting back to work after children itself.
Sure.
So that has to be there. So I think that is the biggest problem. I think we have a great ecosystem. I think a lot of companies are coming forward with flexible timings, with government aided programs, with help, mentorship opportunities.
Yeah.
There's always that special importance that they give when it's for women getting back to work.
Mm-hmm.
But I think women themselves should understand this and start coming out more and start, it's happening, but it should be more. I think they should take more risks, which is the problem. They're very happy with a small margin. That's something that I think they should.
I think initially looking at occupying themselves as the first objective of getting back to work or something.
Yes.
Right? I don't want to waste the time. You can do something that keeps you occupied, but probably they're not thinking big or dreaming big.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, there are a lot of women who are very happy being homemakers, which itself is a great job as well. I'm talking about women who want to do something, but who are still a little bit in 2 minds to do it. I think they should come out and take that risk and see if this is really for them and then move it forward. So I think.
You talk through the various questions. Right? You talked about a lot of your future plans. You talked about the hackathon. You talked about the mentor talks, brand talks, and I think you talked about the fail camp or the fail.
Yeah.
Startup failure. Right. So you're talking about a lot of initiatives you're doing. Right. I also like when we were chatting a little earlier. Also, you talked about the W Connect program and all that. Right. So, so what could women entrepreneurs expect from WSquare in the coming months? Right? If you could. More specific dates or how they could get access to this, who should they reach out to?
So I think all women need to be active on our page. So whatever happens is very active on our website, wsquare.work, or on our Facebook page, Workplace for Her. We'll be updating on everything that's happening going forward. And I think what you can expect out of WSquare is for women, an opportunity for women to scale up.
Mm-hmm.
What we are concentrating on is completely on startups and entrepreneurs and on a way in which they can scale up their businesses, and also for women who have not yet started, aspiring entrepreneurs to actually start something on their own. So we are concentrating only on these two completely,
mm-hmm.
be it in tech or non-tech. It doesn't matter what type of product that you have, but if you have a product and if you are doing it at home, come to us so that we can help you scale up and make it national at least.
Yeah.
If you have an idea and an investment, or if you just even have an idea, come to us and pitch that idea to us. And if we feel it's really worth it, we will definitely make sure we connect to the right type of people to help convert that idea into a business.
Sure.
So these are the two things that we want every woman out there to know that WSquare can do for you. And apart from that, of course, we have the space. You never have to worry about an investment or a finance. can always come and use the space and do make it as well as possible. And we have our workshops and our talks which keep happening every week to give you not just that motivation, but also to connect you to the right type of people.
Right.
The minute you come to these type of talks, you meet at least 5-6 people who have similar things in mind, or at least collaborate with each other. We have a lot of women who in retail connect with jewelry, or in retail connect with networking events, and that way they are able to build up their business. So that is something that you can also expect from every workshop or event that we have at our space. So these are the things that you can probably expect from us. And also we are tying up with a lot of big partners to see how they can also help make things smoother for women. So you can also have access to them as well. So
sure.
We'll be announcing those soon. So these are the places where areas where we feel that women can utilize WSquare to the maximum to basically get back to work as an entrepreneur or as an employee as well. So that's what we are.
And what are your expansion strategies to go beyond? I think you already talked about a partner in Bangalore that you're working with.
Right.
So is that, when are we seeing WSquare in other cities of India? What's your plans for
that? So we have another space in Mumbai as well, which we're looking at opening, but we want to establish WSquare here in Chennai. And if we're able to reach out to maximum number of women here, we're pretty confident we can in other spaces as well. But yes, in the next 18 months, we're looking out opening branches in Chennai, Bangalore, Mumbai and Delhi mainly. And we're also looking at focusing on tier 2 cities. Mainly Coimbatore, Trichy, Sivakasi, places where we have been getting a lot of inquiries asking if we can do a couple of these workshops and trainings for women there as well.
Sure.
So we are looking, so the next 18 months you will be looking at us, we're looking at focusing on the incubation program.
Mm-hmm.
So more than the co-working space, the incubation centers will be across.
Right.
We also went to Hyderabad recently and we're also in talks to see how we can collaborate with T-Hub to see what we can do next.
Okay.
So this is our plan for the next 18 months.
So, yeah. So I think we draw to the end of the interview we want to do with you. But before we leave you to kind of continue with your work, just want to, if you had to pass on, and this is a question that we've been asking other entrepreneurs as well, but I'll give you two questions, right? The benefit of two questions. So in general, to entrepreneurs, if you had to pass on the baton or pass on a message in your biggest learning in just one tweet, 256 characters, what would that one tweet be? This is not for women, for any entrepreneur who wants to, any wannabe entrepreneur.
Okay.
What would that message read? No images, no videos, just one message.
Oh, one tweet is like too less for me, knowing how much I've spoken today. But I think it would be for women, I would say...
No, for anybody. So the next question was specifically for women.
Okay.
The first question is one tweet for any wannabe entrepreneur.
Okay.
The second question
So I would say don't ever... how do I put this? Don't think twice to step out of the box would be something that I would say. I think it's very important to do something different and you shouldn't think twice when you do something and think out of the box. So that would be my message to all entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
So that would say to don't think twice, to think out of the box is one my message to all entrepreneurs.
And the next tweet for women entrepreneurs, wannabe women entrepreneurs.
Yes. Always be willing to take risks is what I would say for women entrepreneurs, because that's the biggest problem that I see. Because to take a risk, they have a lot of things going on in their mind there to take a risk. There's family, there's financial independence, there's children, there's the time that they need to give out. There's so many problems that they think of when they want to take a risk and come out on their own.
Right.
So I think that be willing to take that risk and work for yourself. It's okay to think about yourself once in a while.
You can.
As a woman, I think it's okay to be selfish. So I think go out there and take risks, and whether it works or not, it's okay, but it's just the experience that matters.
Sure.
So that's what I would tell women entrepreneurs.
Fantastic. It was amazing chatting up with you, Vandhana.
Thank you.
We got to understand all the challenges and how you've converted challenges into opportunities. And I don't think so. It'll be fair enough to say you've been an inspiration to many women entrepreneurs, and you've been.
Thank you.
You've not just stopped at being good at what you do, but you've actually taken the learnings that you've had to actually spread the message to other women and kind of open the opportunities for them to think beyond the box, come out of the box, and think. And take risks and all. So I would wish you and your co-founder all the very best.
Thank
with
you.
A lot of future activities and events and the various programs you talked about. We'd be happy if a lot of women took that and get the benefit of it. So all the very best in your journey.
Thank
looking forward to seeing your centers open up in all parts of the world.
Thank you so much. And I also would like to say that you have an amazing idea going on. I think GoFloaters will definitely be helpful for women, like we have been talking.
Yes.
I think it's definitely going to be an opportunity for women to travel less and use spaces across Chennai and utilize the space to build their businesses as well. So I think GoFloaters is an amazing opportunity when I'm looking at women entrepreneurs or women getting back to work. And I hope you guys also go nationwide and spread this across.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thanks. Pleasure talking to you.
Nice talking to you.